हे रितेश, क्या रितेश, आर यू एबल टू हियर मी?
I can hear you, Rohit.
ओके, एक्चुअली सॉरी फॉर द डिले, लाइक द कॉन्टेस्ट वेंट लाइक इट गॉट स्ट्रेच्ड, सो या. सो रितेश, शैल वी स्टार्ट?
वी कैन स्टार्ट.
ओके कूल. So I'll add your screen to the stream. Are you able to see it?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Over to you, Ritesh.
Yeah, so thank you. Thank you very much. So I just want a small feedback if everybody's able to see my screen or not. And from there I can get started.
Yes, Ritesh, we all can see your screen. Bambi, you can click on that hide. Yeah, cool. Perfect.
Okay. So thank you everyone for joining us today and joining me as well. And we are going to have a session right now, which is primarily focused towards machine learning. And we're talking about machine learning. Obviously, it's a big topic, and there are a lot of things happening around with a lot of models, a lot of algorithms, a lot of different processes to make it happen. But we are making it very specific. We have limited time, so we are making it specific, and we are trying to find the credit defaulters using machine learning. Now, what do you mean by credit defaulters? Credit defaulters are the people who generally pay you monthly, but now they might not pay you the next month. So you're trying to figure out people who are going to pay you, on whether the people are going to pay you or they're not going to pay you. So, and we're going to use machine learning to do that. So before we get into the actual thing, a small bit about myself. I'm a Microsoft regional director. It's an honorary title, and I've been an ex-Microsoft and prior to Microsoft with Accenture. And I was an architect and an evangelist, and I do consult with large companies. And I've written quite a few books. So some of the books have been mentioned over here. Some of them are booksellers, also free downloads from Microsoft, Azure.com. So you can definitely go in and read them in your free leisure time. And so now let's get started. So before we get into understanding the actual credit defaulters using machine learning, we should understand what the process is for machine learning. So generally, when you get a lot of raw data, how do you make sure that that data can be used for machine learning processes? So the way it happens is that when you get your data, you need to take it through three main phases, and they are called the pre-processing phase, the training model, and the evaluation. And what you do in the training and the pre-processing phase is, first of all, your data that you're getting might not be the one that can directly use it for your modeling, for your machine learning. So you might have to take your data, undergo through changes. So you have to do some training, which might include removal of empty values, null values. There might be few data which might be biased and things like that. So you might want to make sure that before you start your machine learning process, the data that you're getting it is clean. And after you have your data being clean, how do you know that the data is good? Because if I give you a data which just shows you one side of the picture and does not have the other side of the picture, then it does not make sense to work on that data and taking it through the machine learning process, because every time you use that data, you will get the same prediction and the right prediction that you're trying to do. And so it is important that the data that you have is correct, it's not biased, and you want to find out what's the nature, what the pattern of data, what are the different patterns available within your data. And that is why you do a lot of exploratory analysis, try to figure out different kind of values, try to interpolate, extrapolate data to figure out how your data is spanning out between multiple rows, and columns, or multiple features and multiple types of data that you have. So another important feature called feature scaling, that's part of machine learning that you do typically as part of your pre-processing, which is typically, I'll take you through some subsequent slides on that, but just to understand what scaling means here. Say, for example, you have two set of rows, age and salary. So age typically stands between, maybe 0 to 100, whereas salary could be anything between, say, for example, 0 to maybe 10 lakhs or 20 lakhs, or maybe a crore or something. So you see the scale of both the columns in the data is completely different. And typically, if you try to find the distance between these two columns, typically machine learning follows the Euclidean process, where you find the difference between two coordinates using the x and the y coordinates, so the age and the salary. You will virtually see that this age does not play any role into it because almost it becomes negligible in compared to salary. So you try to bring those values within a particular range so that both the columns can depict appropriately. And typically you do scaling. So you bring data between 0 to 1 for the age as well as for the salary. And then you try to make it go through the process of machine learning so that can give you appropriate results. And you also do feature encoding, which is generally for categorical data. So you have two types of data, numerical data and categorical data within your data set. So what are categorical data? Categorical data are data which are like something like country. For example, something like sex, like male or female, and things like that. Those are categorical data. Whereas numerical data are data which are your numbers, like, for example, the amount paid, the salary, things like that. So we need to encode those categorical data because machine learning algorithms typically work with mathematical functions and expressions, and they don't have much space for strings and they cannot understand them. So we need to convert them into integers, numbers, so that we can put them into the algorithms and those functions to act on them and give us the appropriate results. So we need to do some feature encoding as well. And finally, we have a set of data. If we have a set of data, we need to split them into training and testing because we will take our model through the trained data, but how do we know whether the model that we generated out of the data is good or bad? And to do that, we need to test our model. And to test that model, we need test data. So we break the data maybe into 60-40, 70-30, 80-20, depending on the amount of data that you have. And you set them apart so that you can test your model using the test data to find out how your model is behaving. So after you do the pre-processing, you move to the training model where you do feature selection and engineering. Now that's a very important concept in machine learning because you might have data that you might have hundreds of features, which means features you can, it's not directly one-to-one column, but you can think about it that you have 100 columns in your data set. Now, whether all the columns in your data set actually impacts the result of what you were trying to do. So for example, if you're trying to find out the credit defaulters, does education plays a role into it or not? So that might be playing a significant role. And you might have found out that using your exploratory analysis says it might have some impact, some correlation between the actual feature and an actual thing that you're trying to predict. So, and there might be columns which might not have any correlation. So they might be completely unrelated to each other. And so in those cases, you might definitely want to ignore those columns or remove those columns from the data store. And so it's very important to figure out which columns should be part of your model, which columns should not be part of your model, which columns has more impact on the results that you're trying to predict, and which columns has less impact. And so all of these becomes part of your feature selection and engineering. And then finally, you use the learning algorithm to actually do the processing and figure out whether it's a prediction, whether it's a classification, whatever you're trying to do with your machine learning. You need to choose an appropriate algorithm which gives you the right answers, or which gives you appropriately the right probability of the answers, which makes you satisfied and maybe continue improving on top of it. Finally, whatever the results are, you do a scoring of based on the different experimentation that you do. And when you do experimentation, you typically try to change the feature selections. You try to have different selections at different times. You try to model different hyperparameters based on the algorithm that you've chosen. You do all those changes again and again to find out a better probability of the answer that you're looking for. And then finally, you evaluate all of them, and whichever suits you the best, that becomes the right solution, and that you publish the toy as an endpoint eventually so that people can consume it. You can consume it and get future answers based on whatever model you've generated. So that's how you typically do that. But that's the process of machine learning. And then what are the different types of algorithms? So what are the different kinds of learning algorithms? So typically we have two, supervised and unsupervised. And when you look at the supervised, so supervised are the one when you already have the labels, which means you already have the data for it and you know what kind of data it is. So for example, when I'm talking about country or when I'm talking about salary, I know I can label them, I already know it. But something which I want to predict, like for example, I want to predict the price for car, then I typically use something like a regression, which just gives me a unique number. That number is maybe, you know, 5 lakh rupees. Whereas when you do classification, you're trying to figure out whether a particular category, whether the particular object or class, you might have different classes, and whether the data that you're getting in falls in which different class. You might have a class for, and we are looking at defaulters and non-defaulters. You have two classes, a default, a person who's going to default on credit, and a person who's not going to default on credit. So we have two classes. So when we get a data about a single individual, we can classify it, whether it will fall into a defaulter or it will fall into non-defaulter. And there can be multiple classes. So it need not be binary. It could be more than two classes. Depending on what the scenario is, you might have to classify it. And unsupervised is where you do not have your labeled data. You get raw data. You don't see, you don't have to predict anything out of it, but you want to find patterns within that data. And then you want to find patterns between data, how are data related to each other. And that's where you get into the specific algorithms related to clustering. Now, they both are individually huge topics. They have both a huge number of algorithms and learning models associated with them. And what we are going to look into today is a classification. We are going to try to solve the default credit default problem using classification specifically. And within that, we are going to use something called decision trees. There are multiple algorithms even for classifications, but we are going to use decision tree today as an example. Now, if you just have to understand classification, look at the left side of the image. You have so many, say each one of them represents a row of data, and you have so many rows from them. And if you take it through the process of classification, eventually it should tell you which one, it should fall into three different classes or three different labels. The top one may be the bikes, the second one may be the cars, and the third one being the trucks. So this is the process typically a classification follows, where it can figure out based on the input. It goes through a process and it gives you the probability, whether you know the probability is 80% bike, maybe 10% car, maybe 10% truck. So you know that if it falls beyond a threshold, like maybe if a threshold is 75%, then if it's beyond the 75% for a car, then it goes to the car and gets it. So that's how you do typically classification. And if you have to represent it in a different way, so typically when you have a lot of data, you have to, and you want to predict between two classes like we are going to do, like class A or class B. So you have data, you try to find a demarcation between them so that you can clearly say that anything beyond this line is class B, anything above this line is class A. So the important thing that becomes from a classification problem perspective is, what is this line? How do I identify this line? Because this line, I have to create or find out this line, and that is the basic premise of classification. If you can find out the best appropriate line which can divide the rows or the data between two different classes or multiple classes appropriately with least amount of error into it, is then you have a success factor with classification. And that's what we want to do today. So what are the different kinds of classification? We have algorithms, we have multiple ones, and some of them I have mentioned over here, which are quite famous among the usage within the industry. So something like a logistical regression, though the word regression is there, it's actually a classification. Naive Bayes, which is generally based on a high probability in terms of interdependence and dependence. Decision trees is what we're going to look today. We have some more advanced algorithm-based decision tree like random forest, support vector machines, and k-nearest neighbors, which takes decision trees as some of them as base and build on top of it as well. So it's very important to understand decision trees because they're quite intuitive, they're simple compared to others as well, but that becomes a foundation to other algorithms, learning models as well. So how do we understand what is a decision tree? So decision tree, you always think about, I want to make it very simple for folks, everyone over here, so that you know you feel what decision tree is all about. Generally, if you go at places and try to read in blogs and all, there's a lot of mathematics, there's a lot of concepts, and the learning rate is quite low. So I want to make it pictorially very intuitive so that you understand, and the takeaway is you know what decision tree at the end of the session. So when you look at decision tree, it's more like a flowchart. It's more like if else loops. And you, what I'm trying to do is you're trying to figure out with different features that you have, different columns that you have within a data, and you're trying to see where this data will fall. So maybe you start with the root, which is your, what is the weather today? You want to find out what's the weather today. So when you look at your data and see that there are one column has two different categories called, you know, a sunny and rainy or rainy. And based on that, you divide the data between two different nodes, and that becomes a level one node. And you always assign a probability to it that it looks like, you know, the 75% probability is sunny, whereas it's 25% probability that it's raining. And so within sunny, then you may look at other columns as well and see that whether it's sunny and whether it's humidity or windy or not. And based on humidity and windy, you finally come to a conclusion, yes or no, and you assign different probabilities and numbers to it. So you have leaf nodes at the bottom, which are your final nodes, and you have intermediate nodes and you have the root node. So you always start with the root node, which is one node, and then you keep on breaking down into multiple nodes. Eventually, you're getting more leaf nodes compared to the root node. And typically, what you do is you will see that all the yes belongs to on the right, on the left side, whereas on the right, on the nose typically fall on the right side. So left and right, you will see, and you can follow through it. And I'll show you a real example of how to use this as well using the default creator. So this is what the intuition is for a decision tree. This is how you should do it. So let me take you through another example. So let's say this is our data. If we have an X axis and a Y axis, and we have put our data into this, say there's two features, and we put all our data into this. So you can clearly see how we can do classification over that. So the first thing we have to identify is the line which divides this data into two different halves. So if we see, we can identify one line, and that's the job of the algorithm to find which line divides the data between two different classes. And the idea is that the way the line has to be figured out, or the way the division has to happen between the classes, is that it maximizes the number of items on both sides. So if I have a lot of greens in one side and if I have a lot of reds on the other side, then I have a good classifier. I've done a good classification over here with using decision trees. So the identification of line is very important. And that's the starting point. And we have different algorithms like information gain, Gili model, and things like that, which can be used to actually find this line. So you don't have to do it manually. It's all a job of learning models to find out the best line you can start it from. And so for example, if you have five features in your data, you know, like age, education, college name, and things like that, country, state, city, which feature is the best one to get started from to divide your data into two different halves? Maybe more than initially, maybe two halves, or maybe more than two different halves. And that identification happens by the models like the information gain and Gini model, which I'll show you how it looks like in the subsequent slide. So once it identifies that, then you see that we have on the top a lot of green rows, whereas we have on the bottom a lot of red rows. But is this an ideal place to be at? Maybe not. Why? Because still we have a lot of interpolation. You will see a lot of red ones, even where the majority is green, whereas just vice versa as well. So what should happen? It should continue further. It should go to second level nodes now. This is the first level node that you're seeing. And it might want to break now further. That now if I break this into the first top half, into, you know, if I can identify a line where I can chalk off a majority of the green rather than the rest of the greens, and that's become another decision point. And then I continue this in an iterative fashion. Eventually, you will see that I have different islands I'm creating where I have almost isolated all the greens at one side, different clusters, whereas I have almost all the red ones in a different set, in different regions over here. Though there might be some overlap here and there, and that's where the probability comes into picture, because we cannot be 100% sure about everything. We will try to reach as close as 100%, but you know, there might be errors and all, so we might be 95%, 90%. So you have to identify for your use case what is a good percentage, and based on that, you need to keep on modeling your entire experiments. So once you do that, finally, we come to the confusion matrix, and I'm going to show this live when we do that, and I'll explain that on the Jupyter notebook. But we'll come to this and understand this is a very important concept from a from any classification perspective, whether you're using a probability. So let me go through now, actually, to my notebook and show you how this entire thing works. So I have a Jupyter notebook on my machine over here, but at the same time, you can do the same thing on Azure as well. So if you go to Azure, if you have an Azure subscription, you can create a machine learning service. You can create a machine learning service. And when you create a machine learning service within an Azure, you can create the Launch Now button, which will actually create a workspace for you. And you would be able to write your entire code within your notebooks available within the Azure ML Studio. So this is where you open a site called ML Studio, ml.azure.com. And once you come here, you can easily say, I want to create a new file. And when you create a new file, you can create a file like this, which is actually a Jupyter notebook. So it is actually a Jupyter, and you can execute the entire code over here. And to do that, what I have done to for the default example, what I did was I went to the site, and this is a pretty famous problem as well. You can find it out. It has a data which is about the credit card default. It has a complete data set about it, and the data set is available within the data folder over here, and you can download them obviously. But what I did was I actually went to my machine learning studio, and the first thing I did was I imported the library. So I need Pandas. Pandas is a very famous library to work with your data store. Basically, it provides data frame, which is an important data structure you need, like in a row and column format about your data, to manipulate and work with the model. So if you execute them, and then the second thing you do is the data that you get from that site is in an Excel format. So you read the Excel and you have provided the entire URL for this particular data. And I have told skip the first row because I'm not interested in that, and them into DF. And DF is nothing. So this function returns nothing but a data frame. And so I'm trying to get that data frame into it. And so if I try to expose this data frame, I try to, give me a moment. Just trying to reconnect. Meanwhile, I can show this on my local machine over here. So if you see, I have a same code over here. So I'm running the pandas. So I'm trying to load the data now. To load the data, I'll use the Excel file, which is on my local machine right now. And then what I'm trying to do is if I show you the data itself, this is what the data looks like. So you have multiple columns. The first row I told you I'm going to skip because I don't need that. I have an ID column, limit of balance allowed. So this is for the credit card, how much we allow. So 20,000 rupees, 1,20,000 rupees. What's the sex, education, marriage, age. And for the last 6 months, whether they have done the payment or not. So -1, -2 means they have done the payment. 0 means they have done the payment. Whereas anything beyond that means they have not done the payment. And so for different months, so this is say, for example, current month they have, and this is for the previous month, for last 6 months of data. And what was the bill amount for the credit card for last 6 months? And what was the amount they actually paid? And finally is whether they have a default, whether they have defaulted or not. So 1 means they have defaulted, 0 means they have not defaulted. So this is what the data we have. Now, this is our entire data. If you remember my first slide, I told you that this is our entire data set. So we need to make sure, here what we're trying to predict is this. So if a new row comes over here tomorrow, which says this kind of a data, it should be able to predict and say, no, this guy is not going to default because our prediction should say it's a 0. So we need to isolate this row. We have to remove this row from the data because we want to make sure we play around with this data in a machine learning model to find out this value. So, and that's what we're going to do. So the first thing we do is we copy the data into an X data frame, and then we pop it out. We remove that data from our actual data and put it into Y. So X and Y, so X has all the columns apart from this column called the default payment next month, and Y has only this column with us. So we execute this line, and then we actually divide the data. We actually split the data between the test and the training. So there is a very important library you should always you should know about called Scikit-learn. And that has all the algorithms, all the models to actually do the processing for you, including pre-processing. So that is something you need to have good understanding to start working with, you know, any meaningful data machine learning models. So there is a class called train test split, and we're going to import that. And after importing this class, we are going to divide it between training and testing based on 70% and 30%. So the test becomes the 30%, and the rest will be the training. So we have sent both X and Y, and we are trying to now break this into our training and testing model. So once this happens, we have two set of data now, train and test. We can now actually go and use the decision tree classifier. This is another class available within Scikit-learn, and give it different kind of algorithms. So as I said, there are different algorithms which tries to identify the best fitting line, which will maximize classes on both sides to maximum. So that's what we are trying to do. Random state is all about making sure we provide a seed so that every time we run, it uses the same rows for testing and for evaluating all the features and columns that you're going to use with a decision tree. So we create this class. We create this class, but it does not do anything. We just created an instance of it. We try to fit both our training data into this. What does fitting mean? Fitting means now the process has started, where the process has started of finding all the lines that you saw in my presentation. It said, where are the different lines I need to put? What are the different kind of decision trees and how many nodes I need to put? What should be the level of the nodes? How many leaf nodes should I have? All those information will be now executed behind the scenes using this method, so that when we execute this and score it, we will get our percentages. So now when we execute this, it takes a while and it gives us 72%, which means out of 100 rows, if we send, 72% of the time, it is telling us that the credit default that's going to happen is actually true or not. So once we do that, we can actually go and try to optimize this. We are not happy with 72%. So what should we do? If you're not happy with 72%, either you can choose a different algorithm for that matter, or you have also option of manipulating this decision tree classifier by choosing different set of features, by choosing different hyperparameters, or choosing different values for the hyperparameters. So that way, it can actually make sure that we can be better in our prediction. To do that, we are adding a grid search CV. So CV stands for cross-validator, which means we are trying to pass different values for different hyperparameters and see which one provides us the best value. So if you look at the decision tree classifier and take an help over there, you will see that a decision tree has multiple parameters. We have used a couple of them over here, something like a criteria and a random state, but it has much more than that, but they have default values. You can see that over here. So what is the max depth? Max depth means how many levels of nodes that you need, that you want. You can define that over here. How many min sample leaves, for example. Over here it says one. Now one could be good in some scenarios, might not be good for some scenarios. So we can tune all this and change them to get a different result altogether. So let me show you that, how to do that. So I am saying my max depth ranges from 1 to 6, which means I will keep on changing. From the first experiment it will be 1, for the second one 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And my max sample, min sample leaf, stance would start with 2%, 4%, 6%, 8%. Mind you, this is percent, not absolute numbers. And when I create a grid search CV class, I'm passing these values as part of my grid params. You see, this is my grid params, and this is what I'm passing. Obviously, I'm passing my complete decision tree classifier also to it. And I'm saying I want to score based on accuracy. Now, there are multiple models, I'll come to that, like recall, precision, sensitivity, and I'm looking at accuracy. You may look at multiple ones, one shot aspect. And I want to do it 10 times. And I want to run the jobs in parallel based on the number of processes the machine has. Minus one means however the number of processes you have, use all of them. if you give specifically like two, it will use two par. If you use two, then it is just going to use two processors. Otherwise, it is going to use all the processors. We're going to execute this, which is going to execute for one depth all of these, for second depth all of these. It's like it becomes a grid. It executes all of these together, and it takes a while to execute. And once you execute, it will. Once it executes, so right now you have just defined it, but the execution actually happens within the fit, as you saw before as well, for the decision tree classifier. And once you execute it, you see it takes a while. It's taking some time to actually execute the entire grid. And once this happens, it should happen within a few seconds. So if you see, when it becomes kernel is busy right now. Okay, it happened. And once it happened, it shows us the result, but we can find out now the parameters that is best suitable for us. So if you run this code now, it says if you have the max depth of 3 and min sample leaf of 0.02, you get the best probability. So now if we come back and change our code, we still keep it Gini, we keep it 50, but now we add max depth and min sample leaf parameters as well, and then we try to score it, you see from 72% it became 81%. So that is how you keep on doing experimentation, keep on adding more, keep on changing your parameters, hyperparameters, see how close you can come to your probabilities. And now you can obviously predict. So when you want to predict, you can get the test data now, you get all the text data and get what the Y value should be. The Y, you know, is nothing but whether it's defaulted or not. Now we're going to use our test data for the first time. When we execute this, we can get the value for the white Y over here. We can say. And finally, if you want to see our confusion matrix, which is what I was talking in my slides and explain you now, how our data is. So if you remember, we had 30,000 rows. Out of 30,000 rows, we said 30% is test data, so which means 9,000 rows. So all 9,000 rows have been mentioned over here. What is this matrix is what we need to understand. So let me take you through my slide, make it understand to you. Now, if you come back to this slide, so it represents the same thing that you saw on Jupyter Notebook. So there are four values over here. So the way you read it depends on how you depends on what kind of a problem you're trying to solve, right? So you may say the first one is the predicted value, which is positive. And what is the actual value? So if both matches, so you have a, so the first one says the model predicts that there is a default and the client actually defaulted. That's your true positive. Now, on the other hand, the model predicts a default. You know, it's saying that this guy is going to default. But the client actually did not default, which is your false positive. What is your false negative? The false negative is now just the reverse of it, which says the model will predict it's a good customer. He's not going to default. And the actual, and the true negative I'm talking about, the true negative is when the model predicts a good customer, which means he's not going to default, and he actually does not default, which is true negative. And false negative means he is negative. Negative means the model predicts that it's a good customer, but it's a false negative, which means but he has actually defaulted. So you have all four conditions over here: true positive, false negative, and true negative. Now the good pieces between these four are the true positive and the true negative. They are the right predictions, because if it's a true negative, it means that the model predicted a good customer, no default, and the client actually did not default. And this is when the customer predicted he is going to default. When the model predicted he is going to default, it actually defaulted. They both are the right predictions and they are the wrong predictions. So that's what the confusion matrix is. Now, if you go back and check the same values over here. So this is good and this is good. So roughly out of 9,000 values, we have 1,500 values or 1,600 values which were not predicted. And that is what the 81% was. This is what the 81% was. And if you want to see how this entire code, how the entire decision tree looks like, I have added this over here. So if you execute this, you would be able to see that we have various features. It is using various features like pay zero, pay two, pay five, amount, bill amount, and all of this to find out the different. As you remember, we have three levels of column over here. If you see, we have three levels of depth over here. Max depth is 3, and minimum sample is 2%, which means 2% of the records has to be there in all the leaf nodes. So if you see, it does not go beyond 2%. It has got 2% of the rows. So 2.2%, 2%. So this samples equal to 2% shows that value, that it has not gone beyond 2%. And you can see that the number of nodes are at 3 level. So that's how you can see now the entire decision tree that it has taken. And it's all a probability. The first one, actually, the Gini was 0.345%. And it broke down into 0.779, the value. So around 80% rows came over here, to 22%, 20% rows went over here. And based on that, it keeps on dividing the rows over. That's how you would actually think about decision tree. Now, so this actually, this confusion matrix provides us with some values based on whether it's a positive or negative. But how do we do an analysis on that? And that is where you need to get into perspective, which says, what is a precision, what's a recall, what's an accuracy, and things like that. What is an accuracy? So if you see, accuracy is nothing but true positive by the actual results. Now, true positive by the actual results means true positive plus false negative, which means if you add both of these two together and divide by all the values, you will get the accuracy, right? So the true positive and true negative divided by total will give you the accuracy, whereas the precision is among all the true positive, among all the actual results, which is true positive and false positive, means whichever model, the model gave us positive numbers. It gave us positive and negative. Among all the predicted positive, how many were actually true positive? So that will give us the precision. And the recall is just the reverse, which means out of all the true predictions, which means true positive and false positive, negative, how many were actually positive? So this, the different values associated with them, and sometimes you use a recall, sometimes you use accuracy, sometimes you use precision, depending on what use case you have, what kind of challenge you're trying to solve, what you're trying to predict. Accuracy might not always be the best way to handle it, because say, for example, out of 100 records, 99% said, in your raw data itself, 99% were non-defaulters. So no matter what you do, your prediction will be similar to that. So it will not give you the right figure. Your accuracy will be very high, whereas your recall and your precision might be very low when you actually use it with your test data. So you have to know that
you can maybe you can present.
Could you repeat that?
Actually, the audience is not able to see your screen. So can you zoom it? Or maybe you can. Fine. Cool. Yeah.
So that's how you think about these different parameters, and based on them, you decide which one is the best way to move forward with your model. So being said that, what are the advantages of decision tree? It's a simple intuitive model, and it takes less number of hyperparameters to find it. So you can quickly do it, but at times it might take more time to actually execute. And that's what one of the disadvantages, that it can be time consuming. And it can lead to overfitting. So that's another important concept in machine learning called overfitting and underfitting. Mm-hmm. What does it mean by overfitting and underfitting? I have a slide for that. And yeah, so we can understand using that. So let's say, for example, you have a set of rows in classification and you're trying to find a line. When you try to find a line, if you see on the extreme right, you see you're trying to, you know, just gauge through all the zeros and make it away by creating a line, making sure that each point has been taken care of. That's called overfitting. But overfitting is generally not a good idea, because this might work for your, you know, training data, because in your training data, you're trying to find, you know, if individual one, each data, each row level where you should have the line. You can do that, but when actual test data, it might not work. It will give you huge variance and it might not work as expected. So overfitting is generally not a good practice. So you should try to avoid overfitting instead. And you should also never have underfitting as well, because if you do underfitting, which means typically you have more errors in your modeling and the probability is generally less. So you should be somewhere in between both underfitting and overfitting, like an appropriate fitting, which means you, there might be some errors, that's fine. But when you create a model using your test with training data, and when you try to test with actual values, you don't see much variance between the answers that you get on training and testing. And that is where the appropriate fitting happens for your model. So with that, I almost am coming to a conclusion on my decision tree. So I just wanted to make sure that there are other important concepts you should keep in mind when you're looking at machine learning, something like an imputation. And imputation is about finding, you know, there might be missing data within your, and that typically you do all of these within all these three concepts, imputation, feature scaling, and feature categorical encoding in your pre-processing. And imputation you generally do when you have missing data within your data set and you want to change the data, and you can generally want to change the data using the mean or the medium or the mode, then you impute. So there are multiple algorithms classes available, include in scikit-learn, like a simple imputation. And you can use that to actually just replace them using code. So you can definitely do that. And you can also do feature scaling, as I mentioned in the beginning. And there are a couple of ways to do feature scaling. One is called the normalization, the other is the standardization, and the formulas have been shown over here. So when you do normalization, basically you get the minimum value for that column, you subtract that value from the current value, and you find the range of max and minimum and you divide with that. So the entire thing falls into a complete range. If you want to do standardization, then you find the mean of that column, you subtract that mean from the actual value or the current value, and then you divide by the standard deviation. And these are the different ways you can bring your data within a simple range if you have data like age and salary, as I mentioned. And feature categorical encoding is when you do have categories, as I mentioned, like for example, country, then you can do encoding, which means in case those columns, their string values, they would not make any sense. So I can convert them into integers using label encoders, for example, or I can convert each of them into a different column. So for example, I can show you an example on that. That for example, if we go into my example of, for example, I have a text file, simple file I just created for this demo, which has five columns called area, rent, city, rooms, and new. And so the area of the flat is 200, what's the rent, which city we're talking, how many rooms it has, whether it's a new flat or not. So simple example. And if I want to do encoding of this particular columns, like I will do it obviously for the string ones, not the ones with the numbers. So for the, like for city, if I want to do an encoding, so I can simply use a column transformer or can use an one hot encoder. And when I do a transformation, you see my, this is my data that becomes, which means I have my rent, I have my rent, I have my area, I have also 231, which is nothing but, if you see this 231 is nothing but the number of rooms it has and whether it's a new flat or not. But you see the city? City has been converted into four columns. There are four columns, 1, 2, 3, and 4, because you have four different unique cities over here, Hyderabad, Bangalore, Mumbai, and Chennai. And each one represents a column now. So Hyderabad is a column, Bangalore is a column, Mumbai is a column, and Chennai is a column. And by taking all four together, you will see that only one of them has one, rest all zero. Right. So it did not encode this properly. We have to check that, but eventually you will see there is one in every one of them. Right. So I think, yeah, Bangalore didn't do it because of a capital B over here and a small b. And that's the reason. So that's how it could not do it. But then you can find out the different encoding layers. You can encode your categorical data into either as 1, 2, 3, 4 within the same column. You should do that when the 1, 2, 3, 4 does not generate an order, because 1 is less than 2, so they should not have an order. Like country, if you have country in your data set and if you generate a label encoding like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 within the same column, generally people have a tendency to relate them, you know, 4 is better than 3 and 3 is better than 2 or something like that, or maybe just the vice versa. And so it makes sense to put them into one hot encoder, which one hot encoder will do is just convert them into columns. And if you look at, this is the columns that it becomes over here. And for yes and no, it becomes like this. And if you want to use imputation. So imputation, if you see in the same record, I have one value missing over here. The rent is missing for Hyderabad over here. And I use a simple imputer. And if I see the missing numbers, I'll see that the one missing number is there for rent. And if I use a simple imputer and try to fit it, I actually convert that into mean, I think. It's a mean, it's a medium. I'm trying to put a medium value to it. And based on the medium value of all the rows, this row gets filled. That is how typically I will change or impute my data within my data set as well. So I think that's all I had for the session. If there are any questions, I'll just take it up. So go through it.
Yeah, Ritesh, I think we have a few questions for you. Do you want me to show it on the screen?
Yeah, that should be great. Yeah.
Sure, I'll do that.
Yeah, I can see them as well. So great search CV. It works with more than one decision tree. It can work with other classifiers as well. So yes. So the question is, can great search CV work with other algorithms? Yes, it does work with other algorithms. Not a problem. You can do that. And whether great search CV helps in hyperparameter tuning, it is actually meant for hyperparameter tuning. So you should use great search CV for hyperparameter tuning. What are the other questions we have here? I think that's all I can see.
I think that's all. Thanks a lot, Ritesh, for your valuable time and joining us for the session. So would you like to mention you're also going to speak at Cloud Computing Days?
Oh, yes, absolutely. So that's a great point. So guys, you can, so this was, we having, I think there's another CC Days of 3-day conference happening in the second week of, I think 17 to 19, the exact dates, Rohit can confirm, we are having it. And we are having 3 days of full good sessions, good speakers. And if you're interested, you should definitely join that to have and be participative over there. So I'll be speaking over there as well on a different topic completely, like on cognitive services using trying to identify masks and things like that within pictures. So using machine learning, using custom vision APIs and things like that. So you should definitely be there. If you're not yet registered, please do so. We also having a blog contest going on. So there's a lot of activity happening, and I think this is a good time to utilize your time. If you want to get into blogging, you should get into blogging, and you can also post your blogs over there. There are a few good prizes for that, and you can, and definitely if you win, you know, you get those cool Surface and things like that. So I hope you really all enjoyed the session. You can definitely get in touch with me. My Twitter account is automation, and definitely on active on Twitter. You can also get me on LinkedIn with Ritesh-Modi, and you can stay in touch with me. And if you have any questions, feel free to ask me as well. More than happy to help you. Apart from that, it was great talking to you all. I hope you all enjoyed it, and I'll sign off from here.
Thanks a lot, Ritesh. I'll be sharing your presentation slide with the audience and your details regarding your social media handles and all those things. So thanks again, Ritesh. Hope to see you soon for Cloud Community Days.
Sure, absolutely looking forward.
Okay. Thanks, Ritesh.
Thank you.
Bye.